Okay, today we're going to show you the ways I ground drive my horses. And the bit I use is an O-ring Snaffle, smooth, and it's regular bit you buy at D&B. And I use a Cavesson on him to help keep his mouth closed because he tends to open his mouth to ignore the bit. Except for you pulling on his gums, you'll be pulling on the bar, his mouth here puts pressure, so in fact he will stop and listen to the bit. Some horses require it, some horses don't, depending on the horse and how they take to a Snaffle bit, is either you can use them. And then I use two longe lines. I try to get them as even as possible, and I just connected them to the bit, and ran through the stirrup on both sides. And then before I get going, I flex them. I ask them to flex just for a little while so that by the time I start driving him, he'll remember the flexing, the pressure, the pull, so when I ask him to turn stuff, he will do it. And then I ask him to flex on this side, and to help a horse learn how to flex, I put my hand on the neck, a little pressure, and then ask him to flex. And bend their head, and if you put your hand on the neck when they first start out, it helps wonders to teach them to flex. For some reason, the pressure of your hand there pushing in helps them bend their neck. And pretty soon, I mean, do this first for a while until they're good at it, so you can barely pull them a bit, and they turn, and then start working on the other side of flexing. And then ask them to back up, pull. Just a couple steps, not too much, just enough so you know, hey, I got the picture, I know the pressure the bit is, so when I start ground driving him, he'll know, let's go. You know, he knows pressure the bit, he knows when I turn both directions, when I back him up, he'll know his cue and the pressure pull. So now we go back, grab the driving rein. And it's okay if your horse gets stuck under the horse. Your horse is good for desensitizing for around the legs, ropes, and everything, and just help them get back so that they don't kick you, because every horse is different, every horse gets spooked with the reins or anything. Then put grab gloves, anything to help you protect your hands in case they take off or in something, you don't get rope burn, because that will just hurt your head. And we'll make it a good experience, all these animals. Positive note, so don't end on a negative note. You want to make sure it's positive so it's good for him and you at the same time. That's him along. And then I ask him to walk on. And my blue rein is what I use to keep his head in, focus, so that he will pay attention, so we can keep our perfect circle here. You can either stand in a circle and pivot around as he walks around, or you can walk a distance away and walk with them. But if you're going to walk with them, make sure you're staying where the hindquarters is and not in front of them, where you'll be asking them to stop or to move out or anything. You know, back here is a driving area where they can push them to go up. And then I will ask him to stop and say, whoa, stand. Good boy. Whoa, stand. Now ask him to stop. Give him one stop, and so that he knows. So when I ask him to back up, he'll know the difference between backing up and stopping. So I'm going to back up. So a little pressure on the bit, back up, like I said earlier. Back, hold, in. Good boy. And then you can come up and pet them. Be careful, so they can get startled or spooked, and you know that you're going to hit him or something. You know, say good boy. Go back to where you were. Ask him to walk on. Walk on. Continue on. And all these watches are moving, how they're handling the situation, what's going on around them. And then when I ask them to turn, I shorten my right rein up. I pull lightly on it, loosen the rein up so that I can turn, so that I'm not pulling on both sides of the bit, making it easier. And then I tighten my right rein up so that I can have more control of its head, so turning into a circle. Walk on, make sure he's in tension, and then we'll ask him to stop, hold, and good boy. it's like your horse kind of stops, and that's going to stop automatically because you set the their idea of you walk behind them to take off. Because they think that means go, they need to run, they need to get out of here. And you want to make it so no, you need to walk, you need to listen to cues. Every cue I ask you, backing up, side passing, whatever your cue is, you want them to, it's okay for them to do it at your pace, not their pace. So you stand, and if they take step forward, they just come back, you can stand there, and then, alright, there we go, hold on. And the cue, you continue on. You can make them come in on a circle turn, tighten your wide driveway up, and then tighten the turn, tighten your blue rein up. Possible. You don't want to make any jerking motions or anything. Make sure everything's smooth. And hold the stand. And your horse, at first, will not, when you first start ground driving, will not just walk on like he does. He's been ground driving for almost a year now, and so he knows what to do. But when you first start a horse, they're either going to take off or they will walk and then take off. I mean, either way, they're going to tail off in a bit. And it's best to start them out, have someone lead, there's someone that you trust, someone that knows horses, so that when they start panting and you behind them, ask them to walk, they'll listen and then they'll walk with you, and you guys communicate. You want to turn and do everything slowly so that horse is comfortable and not confused or get tangled up in the bonds of the line because he doesn't understand, and do that maybe 10 times, not too long until he gets it, and then slowly have the person start drifting away so that he doesn't, so that he starts doing things on his own. So the idea of ground driving is for them to do independently, because that's what builds their courage and just do it themselves, just so that when you start riding them, they're not going to have anyone leading them, they're not going to have anyone being there for them to push them on, because you're on them, and they'll be able to take that courage they have, that confidence, to move on and do things that you ask them to do. And ground driving, pretty much do almost everything you possibly can with them, as much as you do as you do riding them. Do circles, both directions, straight, triangle, I mean, anything that you would do when you get on to ride them. It will make them so much better, so when you get on them, they'll know, oh, I've done this before, I know what this feels, I know how to maintain a circle, I know how to do, over a log, or anything. They'll know how to do it, they'll remember that, they'll put two together, so they will do it, and it will make your horse easier to break tracks, they'll know what to do, and they've already experienced it. And when you first start them out, I would recommend you only ground driving is maybe 10, 15 minutes, 20 max, and so that you don't want to overdo it. You don't want them to feel like, oh, I don't know, this is so long. You know, just enough because they're young still and they still need to it. You don't want to overdo it. You know, you want them to make it good. Oh, you know, this is kind of fun and it's new and stuff. So just do it for a little short little time and do it for a long time. I would recommend walking in. Start working on ground driving for a month at a walk. Walk, stop, back up, and so that they can get used of, you know, the idea of walking, because that's your main goal, is to get them to walk, and that's what you mostly do anyway, is walk. That's the basics of ground driving, the walking. And then slowly get into the trot and the jump and the lope, and then you know, work that into the and make sure everything's even. You know, if you're going to do two rounds of trotting, or two rounds of loping, two rounds of walking, you know, make everything even so that you're not overloping or doing more trots than you are loping or walking. So try to make everything even. And then with the backing up and the stopping, what I would do, I'd mix it up. Because I don't want him to know that every time I stop and ask him to back up, he's going to know that's what I want. So instead, I'll ask him to walk on. So I'll ask him to walk on. And what we'll do, we'll walk for a while, and then I'll ask him to stand. And then make him stand for a little while so he doesn't just back up. And then I'll ask him to back up, back, back, double step, not over too much. Hop on. And then this time when I ask him to stop, I'm not going to back him up. I'm just going to ask him to stop so that he doesn't think, oh, I'm going to stop and then back up. He's not going to know that to do that. So I'm going to ask him, whoa, and I'm going to stop. And then we're not going to back up. But he's prepared to back up. He's ready to back up. Now I want him to guess that. Yes, that would happen. So I'm going to make it up and ask him to walk on. And so with doing that, you know, they're always trying to guess what you're trying to do so that they're not get bored of the same pattern of stopping, backing up, or anything. I mean, mix up these circles, these crazy circles, ovals. I mean, anything to get them to, you know, something different. I think that's what it's just like. Imagine walking around a circle, circle, circle. Now mix it up, turn different directions. You have to circle, turn, stop, you know, pivot, you know, try pivoting, you know, or side passing. Do something different so that they don't get bored, because they're like us. They get bored too. It's like working on the same math problem for, you know, 10 minutes. You know, you want to go to a new one, try something different, and then go back later. You know, same thing with them. They're almost like us. They like being different. You know, and they change up a lot. And cool. And continue to work with them until they get down. And pretty soon you'll be able to back them up once you get them to where they know what they're supposed to do, you should be able to back up, back, not U-turn, back. You should be able to back your horse, stop your horse without you having to back up, use rein pressure, you don't want to be able to use rein pressure, you want to be able to actually walk without using the rein to tap him, go. You want everything to be off your voice command, but be able to use sit, catch, and catch. You want them to be so well trained that by the time you get on them, you have to walk, you won't have to kick them off. Or, oh, you know, kind of like, come on, let's keep going. You know, they'll be like, oh, walking. I remember that. I know what that's like. I know what stop means. She says, well, I stop. So it just makes your training so much easier because they know what you did on the ground. So when you move it to the riding part, you'll automatically. Oh, okay.